Hey, hi everybody. My name's Alan. I'm with Trees for Life, and I'm talking about our squirrels project tonight. But let me just start with a wee apology, and my apology is that I'm not Becky. Becky's our red squirrel project manager, and she is on maternity leave at the minute, so she's not able to talk to this. But I will do my best to be a Becky Priestley tribute act. So please bear with me. Our project is basically about bringing red squirrels back to parts of their former range in the north and west Scotland. This was a technique that was pioneered by Roy Dennis. And I don't really know how Roy came up with this idea, but in my mind's eye, I think Roy looks at maps like this, and he felt that he could see the way, if you look at the, hopefully you can make these maps out, but if you can see in the map in the 1945 on the left-hand side of the screen here, the big green area, which denotes no red squirrels or grey squirrels, of course, there was no habitat there. Period of deforestation, what had driven red squirrels out of that former part of the range is that habitat fragmentation and a bit of persecution as well. So isolated populations gradually fizzled out, apart from a few wee dots here and there. And by 2000, that was largely the case. But by then, of course, commercial forestry had started to affect much more of the landscape. And so there actually was presence. That's the kind of habitat and sort of quality actually that red squirrels could repopulate. So I imagine Roy looked at this and thought, well, we could just take squirrels out there. That was still the case in 2000. And so 2008, he did his first translocation. He took red squirrels to Dundonald. And then he went again to Lough Broomside nearby in 2012 and to Alat in 2012. And Becky, I think, was involved in that. And so she was able to learn from Roy how this was done. And it was great that she was able to bring that that skill into Trees for Life with Roy's help. And so we're very grateful to him for helping us with that. And also with some of the big funders that helped us do this. So HLF were great early on. European Outdoor Conservation Association, and particularly the People's Trust for Endangered Species have been a real stalwart, and they and other funders have helped us get this far. You can see here kind of where the donor site area is, this big purple blob around Inverness, and you can see nine of the 10 release sites that we've been to so far. We've just left out Golspie's, not quite on this map, it's just to the north of Spinningdale there along the coast. Are kind of the principles in terms of where we could take squirrels from, that we would take squirrels that were from the wild, not captive bred. We could take them both from woodland and domestic gardens, but we have to make sure that we took no more than two per 200 hectares. These, by the way, were conditions agreed with SNH at the time, Scottish Natural Heritage. So that's on Becky's license to move squirrels. We need to use a variety of sites to make sure that we got genetic diversity. And to ensure that we didn't impact on a local population. There's no point in moving squirrels to another part of the country if we're just going to lead to a population disappearing somewhere else. So really careful about that. We started moving 25 to 35 squirrels per translocation. That was kind of Becky's target number for how many squirrels to move out. Laterally, she's done it more with just about 20. Actually, it's worked so well that 20 squirrels seems to be enough. It's a good gender mix. To find a new population. Trapping methods are fairly straightforward. We kind of pre-bait the area with feeders, so just kind of standard squirrel feeders where they can get peanuts and they kind of get used to the availability of nuts in the area. And then these trap scopes, you can see this trap design here, and they're out there for about 2 weeks, unarmed with nuts inside, and squirrels getting used to coming in and out. And then on moving day, the traps are armed before first light, and then Becky will be at one side, and volunteers will be at other sites, touring around and going away around the traps and just checking them constantly until about 11 o'clock. Any traps that aren't that haven't been filled by then are taken down, but also hopefully we've then caught squirrels. If there are any squirrels in the trap, they've only spent at most an hour in each trap. This is Becky here, and she's health checking a squirrel in a handling cone. So we used to, Becky, in the first translocation, had to take them to a vet, catch any squirrels she caught, take them away down to Granton. But the stress involved in that and the value for that was really low. So we agreed with SNH and with veterinary advice that Becky could health check in the field. She's looking for signs of disease, any signs of, you know, really poor nutrition. And she's also sexing the squirrels so that she knows she's got a good gender mix to put out to the new site. And you can see the box just to Becky's right. And that's kind of the carrying box. When she's finished inspecting the squirrel, if it's good to go, she'll put it in there with some nest material and a few peanuts, and tapes over that hole with duct tape, and it goes in the back of the car, and it's ready to head on to the release site the same day. Sussing at receptor sites is a key part of the process. We need to be taking these squirrels to places where we know they can thrive. So they are places that red squirrels aren't going to reach anyway. There's no point moving squirrels to somewhere that they could go themselves. So these are quite a distance from the existing range. It's critical that where, well, most of the north and west of Scotland is, that there's no threat of grey squirrels. And what, I guess, one of the key outcomes of this this whole project is that we've created new refuges of squirrels that are at real distance. So they're as far removed from that from grey squirrels as we can get them. They've got to be at least 200 hectares. They've got to have some connectivity with kind of woodland around them, and they need suitable tree species to give squirrels feeding sources and a mix of the ages as well. So they've got different conditions and as far as possible feeding year round. There is, of course, we need support from landowners. So that's always a kind of key part of Becky's discussions with the landowner. I mean, unsurprisingly, loads of landowners are really happy to have them, but they do need to think through if they've got squirrels in their woodlands coming in, then that can affect some of their forestry operations. So they need to think about, will there be a conflict with those plans in the future? And if so, then sometimes it's best to leave it until after that or just to move on for another site. Here is showing the release. I'm just going back here, actually, and just mention that the community consultation is another part of identifying our receptor site. So when we've got kind of informal landowner agreement, we'll go to a consultation period and just give anybody the opportunity to comment, but also to kind of get involved in volunteering. We usually get real enthusiasm from local communities for bringing squirrels into their area, and people get involved in helping feed, helping pre-date, helping check for feeding sign afterwards. So that's really great to have. So these two maps just show the impact that squirrel translocations have made. You can see on the left there in 2010, how the north and west, these are kind of, all the dots are reports of red squirrel sightings. And so you can see there was nothing really in the north and west of Scotland in 2010. Whereas in 2020, the blue circles are squirrels that have been sighted that we think are associated with Roy Dennis's translocations, and the red ones are associated with the Trees for Life ones that have happened since. So really start to see the presence coming in there. And you know, working on kind of standard population modeling, we think that these squirrel populations and these sites, they should expand into at least 5,000 squirrels in the long term. So this is a real kind of boost to the biogeographical spread and the resilience of Scotland and the UK's red squirrels. After release, where Becky's checking for, and with community volunteers, checking for signs of how the squirrels have done. So eating signs are usually seen almost straight away, sometimes certainly within 2 weeks. We've seen signs of natural feeding. There is supplementary feeding of nuts around release sites after releases, but we see natural feeding very quickly. Signs of drays being occupied, you can see there. And we pick that up kind of expanding quite quickly into habitat around. So the available habitat is filled fairly quickly, just depending on the lie of the land. And we've now got new populations have established in at least another 8 woodlands in addition to the release sites. So yeah, a real sign that all our sites are securing populations. They're still present now and they're expanding onwards. And just want to show a few slides that kind of speak a wee bit to how squirrels are kind of moving on from the release site. So this is the first one Becky did at Shieldig. And you can see this is one squirrel that appears to move all the way around Inveralligan, crossed quite a lot of open ground to get there and crossed a real distance. So it speaks to how squirrels, individual squirrels, would like to explore the landscape and not actually, in this case, not just use typical habitat to do that. We find that again at Cowlam here, which is not too far away from Shieldig, but you can see the squirrels come all the way down to Achnashellach there and crossed again a lot of open ground and some quite exposed country to do that as well. Again, yeah, clear signs that they will cross some open country, which is not really what we expected, but certainly these, the squirrels appeared in Achnacelle, could not have come from anywhere else. The slide at Plockton just shows how with a habitat network, they'll really quickly move throughout that and fill that available habitat and use woodland cover. So this is kind of just a sign of naturally how they'll use woodland networks. And here, squirrels were released by us at Atterdale, at Rearraig and Plockton. But you can see how, and again with Cowland as well, you can just see kind of in the way putting these together at a distance, but actually how squirrels will quickly fill in the gaps. So the idea of colonizing an area over time and really showing how a landscape can in a small way can come together. This should build and build as time elapses and new populations establish. Any connectivity there is in the landscape will be used, and so hopefully squirrels will continue to kind of expand around these areas where we brought them to. So we hope that over time that we can bring more funding in to go to the north of Scotland. That's probably the biggest gap left in red squirrels. So if there's enough habitat up there, we'd love to get up there and do that, and expand that way. And I think that's all I really want to say. So thanks for that. Hope that was useful. And yeah, cheers.